Hello and welcome to lesson number 3, Glimpses of the Past, written by author S. D. Sawan. Students, I will be doing this lesson in two parts. This lesson gives us a short and precise description of events that took place in our country from 1757 to 1857. It enlists incidents that led to widespread revolts known as the First War of Independence or the Great Uprising of 1857. It gives us a glimpse of how the British East India Company expanded its power in India and exploited Indians, how they robbed landlords and farmers of their land, created situations that led to famines and pushed patriots to launch widespread massacres. But before we begin the lesson, I would like to tell you about the life and works of the author, S. D. Sawan. S. D. Sawan is a Marathi novelist and writer. He was born in a small farmer family in Ajra village, Kolhapur district of Maharashtra. He worked as a school teacher for 20 years. He wrote several books. Some of them are The Gandhi Story, The Story of Jawaharlal Nehru, Swarajacha Surya, and Our Freedom Movement. This lesson, Glimpses of the Past, has been taken from this story, Our Freedom Movement. Now, let us have a look at the first point, the martyrs. At a function in Delhi, O my countrymen, let your eyes fill with tears as you recall the sacrifices of Indian martyrs. So here, as we can see, this story begins with a function at New Delhi, where we can see the eminent singer Lata Mangeshkar giving a rendition to the martyrs of our country. She sang the song, O my countrymen, let your eyes fill with tears as you recall the sacrifices of India's martyrs. Can you guess the song, children? Yes, it is the song, Ae mere vatan ke logo, zara aankh mein bhar lo pani, jo shaheed hue hai unki, zara yaad karo kurbani. Well, surely the song breaks our hearts and wells our eyes, doesn't it? Let us go on to see the reason behind this soulful rendition. And in this picture, we can see Jawaharlal Nehru, Lal Bahadur Shastri and Indira Gandhi present at that function. Now let us look at point number 2, the company's conquest. With its superior weapons, the British East India Company was extending its power in 18th century India. The Indian princes were short-sighted. That upstart Raja, bah, call the English merchants, they will help me defeat him. The people had no peace due to such constant fights. The rivalries helped the East India Company and it could easily subdue the Indian princes one by one. A far-seeing ruler like the brave Tipu of Mysore fought the British till he died fighting. Thank God, there is peace in the country now. No more wars and no looting by thugs. How did the Indians react to these conquests? It is God who sent the British. Our destiny is linked with them. The white man has killed or dethroned our kings. Some kings were not good, but after all, they were of this land. Now we have become slaves of foreigners. The meaning of the word conquest means the subjugation and assumption of control of a place or people by military force. Then, the meaning of the word short-sighted is lacking imagination or foresight, the inability to look ahead and think. The meaning of the word subdue is to overcome or bring under control, to conquer. And then, now let us listen to the explanation. Well, the story dates back to the year 1757 when the British East India Company was slowly extending its power in the 18th century India. The then local rulers were very short-sighted. They couldn't see the through the plans of the British, most of the Rajas or kings sought help from the British in order to defeat other Indian rulers. Due to this constant fights, the people had no peace as their rivalries helped the East India Company. The East India Company could easily subdue the Indian princes one by one. But among them was a wise and foresighted ruler, the brave Tipu Sultan of Mysore. He fought against the British till his last breath. Now, these conquests had a mixed approach among the people. What did they think? The kings thought kings, nobles, and the rich men favored the British. According to them, the British were a God-sent gift and their destinies were interlinked with them. On the other hand, the common people thought, practically, they knew that the British had taken over the powers of the kings under the pretext of the East India Company. They knew that although all the Indian kings were not good rulers, they at least belonged to the same land. They considered themselves as slaves of the foreigners. And rightly enough, the British indeed went on to treat the Indians as slaves. Okay, children, now let us go on to the third point. The British rule during the period 1765 to 1836. Religious leaders preached ideas like untouchability and child marriage. Anyone who crosses the sea loses his religion. All the misery in the world is due to women. The truth was that the Indians had lost self-respect. The British scorned them. The natives are unworthy of trust, incapable of honesty. True, Your Honor, but I am honest. Being merchants, the British wanted quick profits. Their heavy taxes forced farmers to abandon their fields. But your men are taking all my crop. You are still in arrears. If you don't pay next week, I will send you to jail. Inevitably, famines followed. Between 1822 and 1836, 15 lakh Indians died of starvation. Still, the British invented other methods which gave them more profits. The goods manufactured in England should not have any import duty when brought to India. A good idea. The East India Company's laws began to cripple the Indian industries. The British policies ruined the expert artisans and their business. Now let us have a look at the meanings. The meaning of the word preached is to publicly proclaim or teach something. And the next word is scorned. Scorned is to feel or to express contempt or disdain for. The next word is arrears. Arrears is money that is owed and should have been paid earlier but was not paid. Then famines are extreme scarcity of food because of no rain. Now let us listen to the explanation. Then came the era of the British rule from the year 1765 to 1836. During that time, religious leaders preached ideas like untouchability and child marriage. They spread superstitions like if anyone traveled to another country, they lost their religion, and women were held responsible for all the problems. Basically, the Indians had lost their self-respect and the British looked down upon them and mocked them. They called the Indians unworthy of trust and dishonest. Moreover, they were merchants. The British wanted quick profits. Their taxes were so heavy that the farmers were forced to leave and abandon their fields. Naturally, famines followed. Between 1822 and 1836, 15 lakh Indians starved to death. But that did not stop the British from thinking of other profit-generating methods. One such law was that the goods manufactured in England would be imported into India duty-free. Obviously, the goods were imported without duty. They would be much cheaper. These kinds of unfair laws began to cripple Indian industries. the British policies ruined the expert artisans and their businesses. Sad, isn't it? Yes, the British were very ruthless and unforgiving. But there were many people who stood against their exploitation and brought freedom to our country. Now, let us have a look at the next point. Ram Mohan Roy, 1772 to 1833. Ram Mohan Roy, a learned man from Bengal, understood what was wrong with the country. Let us not despise ourselves. Our ancient culture is great, and we are capable of greater achievements. We must first reform our society. Superstitions have been ruining us. He told his wife Uma, cows are of different colors, but the color of their milk is the same. Different teachers have different opinions, but the essence of every religion is the same. He was attracted by science and modern knowledge. Knowledge should be practical and scientific. He crossed the seas and went to England to see what made the British powerful. There he told them, "We accept you as rulers, and you must accept us as subjects. But you must remember the responsibility a ruler owes to his subjects." He even started newspapers, but the suspicious British stopped them in the year 1823. So now, children, let us have a look at the meanings. The meaning of the word despise is to feel contempt or a deep hatred for. The next word is reform, is to make changes in something in order to improve it. Superstitions, a widely held but irrational belief in supernatural influences, especially as leading to good or bad luck, or a practice based on such beliefs. Now, we come to Rajaram Mohan Roy. Rajaram Mohan Roy was a well-educated man from Bengal. He was one of the first social reformers in our country. He knew exactly what was wrong, and he was of the belief that Indians must not consider themselves inferior or look down upon themselves. He believed that our ancient culture was great, and our Indian people were destined to greater achievements. According to him, the first step was to change society by leaving the prevailing superstitions and blind belief. That was the root cause of all the problems. Once, while talking to his wife Uma, he told her that cows may be of different color, but the color of their milk is the same. What does that mean? It means that different teachers might have different opinions, but the essence of every religion is the same. He took a very keen interest in science and modern knowledge. According to him, knowledge should be practical and scientific. He even published newspapers, which the British stopped out of suspicion in 1823. He was very inquisitive, and he wanted to know what made the British so powerful. So he crossed the seas and travelled to England. There, he is known to have told the Britishers that we as a nation accepted their rule. He added that they should accept Indians as their subjects and never forget their responsibility and duty towards them. Rajaram Mohan Roy was known for his efforts to abolish the practice of sati and child marriage. Now, children, let us go on to point number 5, which is oppression. This happened during the period 1765 to the year 1835. But the British continued to oppress Indians. In 1818, they had passed Regulation 3. Under it, any Indian could be jailed without a trial in court. All the time, the British officers in India drew big salaries and also made fortunes in private business. By 1829, Britain was exporting British goods worth 7 crore rupees to India. Governor General Bentinck reported back home, "The bones of the cotton weavers are bleaching the plains of India. The British prospered on the company's loot while Indian industries began to die." Now let us have a look at the meanings. The meaning of the word oppression means a very prolonged, cruel or unjust treatment or exercise of authority. Prosper means to succeed in material terms, to be financially very, very successful. Now let us have a look at the explanation of the lesson. The British continued to find new ways to bring misery and suffering to the Indians. For instance, they passed unfair regulations that kept them at an advantage, like Regulation 3 in 1818, under which an Indian could be jailed without a proper trial in court. As they continued to suppress the Indians, they created all sorts of favorable circumstances to uplift their own officers. The British officers drew huge amount of salaries. And not only that, children, I would like to tell you the vast difference between a British officer and an Indian officer. A British officer used to get a salary of rupees 150, whereas the soldier of the same rank would get only rupees 7. So you can imagine how vast the difference was. Then the British officers drew huge amount of salaries, and they could also deepen their pockets by making a fortune out of their private business. The British were exporting goods in huge quantities from Britain. By 1829, they were importing goods worth 7 crore to India. As a result, the British grew richer and richer, leaving the Indian industries high and dry. Governor General Bentinck had conveyed to Britain that the bones of the cotton weavers are bleaching the plains of India in order to highlight the plights and the misery of the traditional cotton weavers in India. This means that the cotton weavers were forced to starve because the cotton mills set up by the British in England, they produced much cheaper cloth with the help of machines that led the traditional Indian handicrafts to extinction. So for today, we will stop here. I hope you read through this lesson up to point number 5 and think of all the countless sacrifices made by all the Indians and whom we have to thank. So thank you, children, and have a nice day.